Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, Steve Jones Show for Tuesday, July 2nd, News Radio 1070 WKOK. We're at stevejonesshow.com. We're also on Facebook. Give us a like. Follow us on Twitter. Twitter handle at Steve Jones PSU, and you can subscribe to our free Steve Jones Show podcast. We're on iTunes, Apple Podcast app, Google Play. Search Steve Jones Show and hit subscribe, and we'll drop the shows right to your smartphone and tablet. And if you want to catch up on some previous shows over the 4th of July holiday, we got 3 months of them archived at stevejonesshow.com. I'm Sean Carey. Steve will be in the Sunbury Motors studio in just a moment. Sunbury Motors, Ford, Lincoln, Hyundai, North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia on the strip, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We'll be with you live till 5, then we'll have our late day news roundup. Mack Trillo at the anchor desk this afternoon, 5:06, and then we'll have Phillies baseball for you tonight. 6:45 will be the on-deck time and first pitch at 7:20, as the Phillies will be opening up a three-game set down in Atlanta as they take on the 50-35 first place in the NL East Atlanta Braves, seeking to expand their lead in the division. And the Phillies looking at this as an opportunity to get back in the race. Braves are up 5.5 games over the Phillies in the division. After trailing the Phillies by just 3 games at the end of May, Atlanta went on a sizzling 20-8 in June. 20 games in a calendar month. That's the first time they've done that since August of 2013. So the series will start tonight. Dallas Keuchel will be going for the Braves, and waiting to find out who the starting pitcher will be tonight for the Phillies. Currently sitting at 44-40. They dropped 2 out of 3 in Miami over the weekend to start a 9-game road trip. That will lead them into the All-Star break. They'll be playing at the Mets this weekend. Sunday, they defeated the Marlins 13-6. They had yesterday off. The Braves suffered a bullpen meltdown on Sunday in New York. The Mets were able to score 5 in the 8th for an 8-5 victory. And the Braves completed their last road trip with a record of 6-4. So we'll have that for you tonight, 7:20.
Yeah.
First pitch here on WKOK. By the way, we're following Women's World Cup.
Semifinal England
is underway between Team USA and England, and some big news.
Yes, indeed, big news. Megan Rapinoe is not starting. But the England, for the first time in the World Cup, trails. The U.S. has done it again. They've scored in the opening 15 minutes, and they lead it 1-0. Okay. So that's where we are.
Yeah, Rapinoe was not out on the field for team warm-ups, but a U.S. Team spokesperson said did not get in to say if it's an injury or not, but also said that it's not disciplinary. So it'll be interesting to get Jill's take at the end
maybe,
of the match. See what she was thinking there.
But maybe she got banged up either in a workout or even in a victory over France. Maybe she got banged in some way, shape, or form. But she ends up playing 23 minutes today. You know what I mean? In other words, maybe banged up, but well enough to play and contribute in the stretch run.
And ironic, it was Kristen Press who was in the game in the starting lineup for Megan Rapinoe with that
scored.
Opening goal. Yes.
Yeah, she scored.
Off and running.
So they don't need her. All right, so...
Much ado about nothing.
Again, much ado, nothing.
Nothing to see here. Move on.
And that's been the story of this show. Nothing to see here. Move on. Oh, my goodness.
Get that trending on Twitter. See what we can do.
Oh, hashtag nothing to see here. And yeah, it's the first time in the World Cup England has trailed. So my impression pretty much the U.S. has enough to win now. All right, so we'll see. We'll see moving forward. The Phillies, we're going to talk with Matt Leon today. So we're going to get into the Phillies a bit. We're going to talk to Chris Mack today. We're going to get into the Pirates a bit. We're going to talk with Neil Coulong today. We're going to get into the NFL 18-game schedule idea today. Tomorrow, Ryan Snyder is going to join us. We're going to talk about recruiting and the verbal commitments. So we have some well-rounded talk coming up here, right, on a wide variety of topics over the next 2 days. So that's what we have coming up. We were going to do a poll on what is your favorite sports month of the year, but we don't do silly stuff like that. So... Because one of you may say August, and I'm going to sit back and go, you've got to be kidding me.
I was thinking about this going home last night. We were talking about, you know, quite a bit of NBA free agency on yesterday's show, and we dove into the Lakers a little bit. Literally not two, but only three players right now on the Lakers roster. I'm curious, the players that will fill the rest of the roster, I wonder how many of them will be former players that played with LeBron James.
Possible. First of all, one of them could be Kawhi Leonard.
This is true.
They have room for another max. So one of them could be Kawhi Leonard. Right, now, how do you fill the rest of the roster? And they very well may be people that did play along the way with LeBron James. But remember, a lot of the guys that LeBron's played with the last few years with Cleveland are older players now. I mean, they're older.
Now then they would get them on the cheap, that's for sure.
Yeah. How much they have in the tank, who knows? And, that's interesting. How much he's driving this? How much he's involved? I don't know. Nobody. You'd have to be there and a part of it and seeing what's going on to know how much he's a part of it. You know, to really know. This is all the view from 30,000 feet. But the bottom line is they're trying to do everything they can to make themselves relevant. They made a big trade to get Anthony Davis, who's a mega talent. You already have a mega talent in LeBron James. If they were to sign Kawhi Leonard, then they would go back to being like the Miami Heat, quote, that hated franchise that everybody had to watch. Right? You know, Laker fans would love them. You know, there's plenty of Laker fans across the country. I mean, they'd love them. The rest of the country would be like hoping to, you know, for them to lose. You know, when Miami lost to Dallas, the Mavericks had more fans that year than they ever realized. You know, because they beat the villain. They beat the villain. And the NBA has done a very good job over the years of creating heroes and villains. And the NBA's, obviously, I'm an exponentially bigger college basketball fan than NBA fan, even though I know the NBA has the best players in the world. But their marketing and their brainstorming of what they're doing, they're way ahead of everybody right now. They're way ahead of everybody. I mean, they'll come up with ideas. Now, things that we've discussed in the show, let's just talk about... Right? 2015, which commissioner in November 2015 or 16? I can't remember. It may have been 2016, November 2016. Which professional commissioner wrote an op-ed in the New York Times about sports gambling in this country?
That'd be Adam Silver.
Yeah.
Yep.
He did. All right. Which one stepped in to the Clipper situation on ownership when Donald Sterling, right, comments came out, right, upset the players? And who stepped in and made sure there was an ownership change? They did. I guess you're not supposed to call them owners anymore. It's you know, in the NBA, I guess that word's out. Now, which league has then in the idea of brainstorming? Because the part about sports gambling, that was Adam Silver, NBA commissioner, brainstorming that he had a sense as to where everything was going and that they would embrace it. Well, now it's the latest. They're talking about, do we need an 82-game schedule? Can we have a better product with 60? I mean, we just watched Kawhi Leonard play 60, and Kawhi Leonard did not miss 22 games because of an injury. Kawhi Leonard missed 22 games because they wanted to rest him. England has tied it, by the way, at 1. So England is on the board. They have tied it at 1. But they seem to be, of all the leagues, the ones that are coming out with ideas. It doesn't mean every idea they have is great, but they seem to be the ones that are always thinking a little bit outside the box. How about that? And I give them a lot of credit for that. I mean, I give them a lot of credit, but they think a little bit outside the box. They're trying to think, how can we make the game better? Now, what's helped them to think outside the box is the $2.6 billion a year television deal they now have that has allowed them to have the economic freedom to make some of the decisions they're making, or the economic freedom to brainstorm some of the ideas they have to see if it's possible to make them reality. As for the sports betting part, they know darn well that if they can figure out a way to get even 1% of it, and that's the key for them. You know, you want my product? We have to get 1%. Well, that 1% would make an incredible difference in salaries. That 1% would allow them to then have a shorter season because they'd be getting a revenue source that has fallen from the sky. Because in the end, what will allow leagues to approve what's going on gambling-wise is going to be what cut they get. You want to put our league on the board? Got to get a cut. So that's what we have in the show today. But that's where the NBA has. They seem to be the ones that are in the NFL. The NFL is a read and react league. They're constantly reacting. Major League Baseball, I think that Major League Baseball tries. I really do. It's just, but Major League Baseball, I mean, they've tried everything. Interleague play, DH in one league. There's a lot of things that they've tried. And Major League Baseball is doing well financially. They're a $9 billion a year business. But not everything they're doing right now is gaining traction with the fan base, especially young fans. The NHL, I think they're trying to be somewhat forward-thinking with some of their rule changes. Now, one of them years ago was incredibly forward-thinking. That was eliminating the two-line offside pass. That's why the stretch pass is so exciting now in the NHL, because they had the foresight to get rid of the two-line passes and offside play. But the NBA seems to be the one that's always trying to think a little bit outside the box. Instead of reacting to what's going on, they're trying to forward think as to what the game's going to look like in 5 years. All right. Take a break. Back with more in a moment. Brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
England and U.S. 1-1, 25 minutes deep. And 1-1 right now. Nothing Alyssa Naylor could do about that. Alyssa Naylor could not do anything. It was just a really... So, that's where it stands right now. Phillies play tonight. And so we'll keep you updated on that as the afternoon goes. Chris Mack will join us. We're going to talk about Josh Bell, who had 3 home runs last night. He's also going to be in the Home Run Derby on Monday. Get a little bit into the All-Star Game, too, and the festivities. Then Neil Coulong at 4:06. We'll talk about the NFL. I want to get into the 18-game schedule possibility with him. Is it a negotiating chip? Is it a reality? Or are there other reasons for it? And then the final half hour, Matt Leon from Philadelphia. We're going to talk about the Phillies. We're going to talk a little bit about the Sixers and the and NBA free agency. So we have a wide range. And then Ryan Snyder on recruiting tomorrow on Blue White Illustrated. So we'll talk recruiting tomorrow, too.
Full boat heading into the holiday. Love it. I will say this about Team USA Women's Soccer. We've heard a lot about Megan Rapinoe, of course, starting on the bench today for Team USA. Carly Lloyd has had a great World Cup so far. One name we really haven't heard all that much is Alex Morgan. Could be her moment here to really step up.
Hurt.
Yeah.
She's playing hurt. I don't care what they did. I mean, they're not going to tell you. But something happened either in the second matchup with Chile or at the end of the Thailand when she scored 5 goals. She's not moving the same way she did against Thailand. I mean, to her credit, she's out there gutting it out. But yeah, I'm getting the sense that she is not 100%. How about that? Well, Sean's 100%. That beats the guy on Friday who mailed it in.
Really?
Oh, my goodness.
Man.
Except for the time he talked about IndyCar. He was 100% then. Then I mentioned Antonio Brown's name, and he checked out.
Oh, boy. Just making it clear to everybody, we will not be checking out this Friday. We will be here Friday.
Yes, we're here Friday.
You betcha. I alerted the king. Just gave him a heads up just to...
The king is going to call us from a barbecue.
Yeah.
I doubt that.
Yeah, but he deserves it.
He does deserve it. He's gone through a lot. He has gone through a lot. Wow. All right. Chris Mack next half hour.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
We're just saying during the break how much we miss Mike Filazzo. All right, welcome back.
You've mentioned, by the way, on the show quite a bit, you miss Harry. Harry sends his best to you, by the way. Caught up with Harry Bingaman last night, our longtime chief engineer for a quarter of a century at Sunbury Broadcasting. We were catching up at Pine Otter Days in Northumberland, opening night last night, King Street Park. Great crowd, great food.
Yeah,
that continues
great
through Friday. So, but Harry sends his best to everybody here. So.
Jeez, I miss Harry.
I told him that. I told him a while back when one of Harry's fun lines as he was starting this new chapter in his life, all pension, no tension. I remember I shared that with you during a break not long ago, and I said, yeah, Steve about fell out of his chair when I said that to him. All pension, no tension.
I loved it.
Yeah.
I loved it. We got some guy running around in a fire hat trying to put out fires. I miss Harry. I got it. We're all right. As opposed to, I don't think we're going to be. I'll save the day.
Okay. 1 month away till you know what. Best month of the year.
Oh, my God. All right. Let's get to today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors. The U.S. leads 2-1, by the way. Alex Morgan did score. So, 2-1 U.S. I'll tell you, this has been fun to watch. I mean, there have been scoring chances. There have been great opportunities. I mean, it's been fun.
Yeah, it's only half an hour in, too.
I mean, that's one of the problems with the men's game on this level is that they're so defensive-minded. I mean, you wonder why the Cantor goes absolutely insane and says goal for 2 minutes? Because he knows that's it. It's like he knows that's it. That's my one today. All right, now with this, I mean, they play a fun game, fun style. All right, Josh Bell had 3 home runs last night. Josh Bell has been on an absolute tear. And he's going to be in the Home Run Derby on Monday. So, with that in mind, let's bring in Chris Mack from Pittsburgh. Chris, first of all, to you and yours, a happy and safe 4th.
Same to you, Steve. Hopefully it's a beautiful weekend, and you get to spend it with some family and friends and loved ones.
Absolutely. Same to you, my friend. Well, let's get to Josh Bell. There are certain guys in certain sports that end up becoming the price of admission. He had 3 home runs last night, but that's just a continuation of what he's done. What is it about his game where he has made that improvement from 1 year to the next?
You know what? I think a lot of it has to do with, and I hate to put too much credit or too much blame on the shoulders of position coaches in baseball, because I know that can be fleeting in some instances.
Sure.
But, Rick Eckstein and Jacob Cruz have come in, replacing Jeff Branson and Jeff Livesey of last year's coaching staff. And, Josh Bell has raved about them, and as have some of the other guys, some of the young guys who have really found themselves over the last couple of months, Brian Reynolds and Kevin Newman in particular. And I don't think that's any small coincidence that those guys have come on board and that we've seen a lot of these young hitters take off, Josh Bell in particular.
Right.
And I think there's a renewed patience in him at the plate. I mean, it's the era of 3 true outcomes, so everybody strikes out a ton.
Sure.
But he has shown the ability, I think, especially over a tough month of June. I think he had 208 in June, to sort of find his patience again and find the ability to sort of just sit back and wait for his pitch. And he got 4 of them last night, and 3 of them he absolutely crushed. The 4th one was really close. So it's just something, too, to see the RBI total.
Yeah.
That's the really – I mean, the home runs are fun, obviously, and the home runs drive that. But to see a guy that's on pace for 140 RBI is it's mind-boggling for a team that, you know, we didn't think was going to score any runs coming into the season. That's the real kicker of the whole thing, is that they've got the best offense in baseball over the last couple of weeks, or one of the best offenses in baseball, certainly one of the best over the last month as well. And here we are, they're scoring runs to beat the band. They've almost turned that run differential around that was so poor early in the season. And he's at the top of the heap. He's been incredibly fun to watch.
Here's another part. Another part is this: what impresses me about Bell, though. Bell is now, quote, a veteran. He's been through this now for years, which means there's an established book on him. I think what the young players are doing is nice, but there's no book on them. So they're taking advantage of no book. Which, you know, look, you can go out there and not be good enough and not hit. These guys are good enough to hit. But again, they are taking advantage of no book. What Bell's doing is remarkable, because there is a book and he's killing it.
Yeah, and like I said, that to see the way you can see the struggles early, mid-June, you know, when there were some particular at-bats that I'm thinking of, you know, that series where the Brewers were in town. I want to say it was almost a full month ago now, and he was flailing away at some low and outside pitches. I remember a really ugly at-bat against Zach Davies in particular.
Sure.
And since then, he's sort of recentered himself. And you don't see very many ugly swings, which is remarkable for, again, in this era, a guy who has 25 home runs at this point in the season, to not have that many ugly swings and to really be driving the ball. The hard contact is just, I don't think he's had a home run ball hit less than 94 miles an hour
right.
velocity, and he's spraying it all over the place so that when he does make hard contact, even if it doesn't go over the wall, it's an extra base hit.
Yeah, that's why I always talk about the young players. Look, they're taking advantage of the talent, the whole thing, but there's no book. Bell's got a book. So you want to be impressed? Be impressed with the guy who's made the adjustments already, and he has done that to his credit. Is there any? Now, it's going to be fun for the fans in Pittsburgh that on Monday he'll be in the home run derby. Is there any concern at all? Because the vast majority of the guys that do the home run derby thing fall off in the second half because in the spirit of competition, they start changing a little bit to try and do certain things.
Yeah, and there's actually been, you know, I dove into a story, it's a couple of years old, but an interesting story done by MLB.com actually in the wake of the 17 home run derby, 2017.
Yeah.
And they actually showed that the home run derby contestants don't fall off any more than all the other all-star competitors. So it may just be, you know, not getting the break in the middle of the season is what drives some guys' numbers down, rather than the home run derby specifically. I think the other interesting thing is that he has been uber prepared for this. Like, he's been calling around to people, asking advice. He talked to Andrew McCutchen this week about his suggestions for the home run derby, and Cutch told him, you know, swing at 70% and let the bat and the ball take care of the rest, you know?
Yeah.
So he's been thinking about strategies. I saw him talking to MLB Network last week about, you know, whether he wants to hit from the left side the whole time or take a couple hacks from the right side, because it's a little more natural for him and it might be a little more fun to be one of those guys who switches in the middle of the home run derby. Mm-hmm. There's been so much, you know, he's going to take a day, I think, at some point this weekend maybe, and just spend, you know, basically try to replicate in the cage pregame what he would do during the derby, you know, just to sort of test his body and make sure he's prepared for it. And I think that kind of, it speaks to a couple of things. One, this guy is just always prepared, whether it's, you know, going out and working his tail off at first base in early work, or whether it's you know, preparing for the home run derby. I mean, it's no small reward here, in that if you win the home run derby this year, you win $1 million. And then there's like bonuses on top for distance and how far you hit the home runs. And that would essentially triple his salary. He'd go from making $500,000 this year to $1.5 million. So, I mean, I give him all the credit in the world.
He got that.
He's embraced it, and he's fully prepared for it. So I don't expect, you know, it will be tough, I think, for any all-star competitor, especially one who hasn't been there before, to adjust to not having those four down days in the middle of the season,
right?
Especially the dog days when it's hot, it's 90, it's 95 out, you're going out every day, and he's in the lineup every day, he doesn't take days off. So I'll be curious to watch his endurance and how that affects him, you know, when you get late July, mid-August, that sort of time frame. But right now, I'm just I think everybody's looked at pretty much as 99.9% positive side of this, which is it's going to be a Pittsburgh Pirate.
Absolutely.
And a really marketable Pittsburgh Pirate, a guy who should be one of the faces of the game out there on the national stage. And I think people, you know, since the game was on ESPN last night, it was kind of cool that the country, or at least baseball fans who knew to watch ESPN, their baseball coverage last night, got to get a little taste of it early. And now, you know, next Monday, that'll be sort of like, oh, yeah, I remember this kid from Pittsburgh, the one that mashed all those home runs against the Cubs last week. I'm really looking forward to it as a moment for him specifically, and to a lesser extent, the team.
Has he said who his pitcher will be?
Yeah, it's going to be a friend of his who's now the third base coach for the Indianapolis Indians. They came up together at Pirate City when they were right after they were both drafted. And so they know each other really well. This is the guy that throws BP for the Indianapolis Indians every afternoon before their games.
Yeah.
I had been lobbying, as I know a couple other people had, to get his dad out there throwing to him, because his dad is just a huge hulk of a man. He's jacked, and it would be really fun to see him standing out there on the mound at Progressive Field. But Josh actually had a funny line. He said, you know, if you've seen my dad, there's a reason he bought a pitching machine for me at a young age instead of threw BP to me. It's because he's just too tight up top to come around. He's a beast. He benches like 430. He's got an old friend from Pirate City and from the Pirates organization to throw to him. Hopefully we'll be able to get to watch his dad from the stands.
A couple more questions, then I'll let you go. One deals with this. The Pittsburgh hosted, and brilliantly hosted, I thought, the All-Star game. Just did a great job with it. Is there a purpose still to what is essentially a meaningless exhibition game, and is there an economic benefit to the city that does host it?
I think there's, I mean, tourism being what it is, I think there will always be an economic benefit to the host city. Mm-hmm. I think Cleveland will see that, you know, next week, this weekend. I think, you know, the game itself, is there still a purpose for it? I think when you look at some of the guys that will be starring in the game this year, you know, I imagine Pete Alonso will probably get named as a reserve at some point.
Right.
You know, guys like him, guys like Josh Bell, guys like Cody Bellinger, you know, these young guys who maybe won't get showcased a lot otherwise will get a chance to be in front of the country.
Right.
I think it's good for the marketing of the game itself. You know, is there much use for the actual physical 9-inning game? I don't know. You know, it's tough because All-Star games, it feels like we're constantly trying to fix them.
Yes.
To make them what they were when we were younger, you know, when Pete Rose was barreling through Ray Fosse at the plate.
I watched that game.
Yeah, but I mean, it's a different element now, and I think if we can come to grips with that, whether it be the MLB All-Star game or, you know, the NHL doing their little 3-on-3 tournament in the middle of January, or even the Pro Bowl, you know, if we can kind of take it for what it's worth and just let it be a celebration of the sport to whatever extent it can be, I think it's still fun to watch, you know, especially for kids who, you know, maybe don't get to stay up and watch a ton of games in April, May, and September, and maybe their team's not going to be in the playoffs, to see one of their guys on the national stage being celebrated. I remember that as a kid, being a fan of the Pirates in the late 80s, and there weren't a lot of moments to celebrate before, you know, the Bonds and Bonillas and Van Slykes of the world came along, and that was one of those opportunities. So I think for fans, it's still fun, and I think in Cleveland in particular, which is just a great host city for things like this, it'll be a blast.
Final question. As we've hit July, Chris, have the Pirates, with their recent surge, have they put themselves in a position where they are now a potential buyer?
Not yet, I don't think. I don't think they're going to sell off anything large. I think the Vasquez rumors are just that. I think the Dodgers are trying to push some things out there to maybe kick some rocks over and see if they can't take advantage of that situation if the Pirates go in the tank. But I think, you know, unless they continue to rattle things off, you know, this 10-5 stretch turns into maybe, you know, a 30-10 stretch or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, this big long stretch that they have of divisional games that runs through almost up until a week before the trade deadline. If they can make hay during that stretch, if they can get themselves to within two games of a wild card, within five games of the, within, you know, maybe three, 4 games of the division lead, because no one's running away with the Central right now, will they be buyers themselves? I don't know, but I don't think we'll see them sell off quite maybe the way we expected them to even just a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, because one of the potential buyers for Vasquez, I think, changed up a little bit today. The Red Sox are going to name Nathan Eovaldi when he comes off the IL as their closer, which I think is a great move because I think he throws hard and can do so one inning at a time. So,
right.
All right, Chris, to you and yours, happy, safe 4th. Thanks so much for everything.
Steve. Tell everyone up in Happy Valley to behave themselves this weekend.
I can say it.
But... Well, yeah, I mean, you can suggest it. You can't really. It's only a hope and a wish, Steve.
Hope and a wish. Chris, thanks so much. Appreciate it.
We'll talk to you soon.
Chris Mack in Pittsburgh. Now, coming up in the next half hour, we'll talk with Neil Coulong about the NFL, maybe the 18-game schedule, and Matt Leon and the Phillies and the Sixers in the final half hour. We'll come back with more in a moment, brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right, Megan Rapinoe is out today with a hamstring injury. And now, it doesn't mean she won't play, but this is one of those, how much time can you buy? In other words, if the U.S., which leads 2-1 at the break, if the U.S. can make this a 3-1 matchup, 3-1, and they don't have to play her, that buys time to play in the championship game. So this is a, what can the U.S. do to buy time to keep her out of this match? Right? It's a hamstring, so you don't really want to play too many games with it. It's interesting, as much as Megan Rapinoe has meant to this, and she has meant a lot, she has been the MVP of this World Cup. I think it's fair to say, right? Sean, she's been the MVP of it. I mean,
yeah,
she,
despite the fact Alex Morgan with 6 goals, but yeah, just the impact that Rapinoe has had here, yes.
Yeah, but in the knockout round, Rapinoe had 4 goals.
Yes.
Right? I mean, in the knockout round. I mean, she's been the best player out there, period.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, you know, everyone, oh, the impact and how important she is and this, that, and the other thing. How many people, how many times do you hear people call her Rapinoe? I've heard a lot of people call her Rapinoe. I'm like, what the heck? I mean, if you are... trying to promote the sport, that would bother me. That, quote, your biggest star, now maybe Alex Morgan's the biggest star, but okay, but one of your top 2 stars, people can't pronounce her name. I mean, that would bother me. You know, if I'm trying to promote my sport and like I can't even get people to pronounce her name right. Right? And again, the Olympics will come up next year. I don't know if she wants to continue and play in the Olympics in Tokyo or not next year. I don't know. I mean, one would think in a World Cup this might be the end of the line because the next one's in 2023. And I don't even know where that one is, do you? Have they announced that yet? Where the next one is?
Well, we can look it up. Not sure.
Yeah, I don't know. Because the men are in Qatar in 22, and then the U.S. gets it with some help from others in North America. But the vast majority of it's in the U.S. in 26. But that's... You would think at her age, it might not... This might be, quote, in terms of the World Cups, the end. Now, the Olympics, she could play in the Olympics next year in Tokyo. But see, that would bother me if I'm trying to promote the sport when my, quote, one of my 2 biggest stars, Alex Morgan's an easy name to pronounce, but you would think everybody by now would know Megan Rapinoe, but you know how many times I've listened to national sportscasts and things like that? I'm talking, you know, radio. I'm talking about radio, not TV. Where I've heard her name mispronounced, and I thought to myself, wow.
FIFA is not expected to announce a host nation for Women's World Cup 2023 until next March. Nine countries are still in the mix, including Japan, Brazil, and South Africa.